Hello, students. So today our lecture is the general materials selection factors. Now I dedicated an entire section, an entire lecture for material selection. This is very important. Now the material selection is part of the physical characteristics of products. But I dedicated an entire section because we need to cover several factors that you need to consider in the selection of materials. Now, this can be used, this can be used for ergonomic analysis and for design. So, for example, if you're designing a cutter, okay, a new cutter, and you need to analyze existing cutters for mistakes in the design. Now, part of the physical characteristics of this cutter are the materials. So you need to decide in the analysis whether the materials that were used in this product were correct or not correct and why, okay? So for example, did the designer make a good choice in choosing a certain metal for this part, for the knife? Why is this metal, not plastic, okay? Why is this part, for example, a certain plastic? Why is this a rubber, okay? So you need to know in general about materials. You need to know, have general knowledge about materials, because when you describe the physical characteristics of a product and you try to find mistakes in the design, materials are a very important part of this. So later when you come, for example, to the design stage, you need to design this cutter, for example. You need to again decide what materials should I use? Any product, okay? For any product, anything around you, you need to decide, are the materials right now chosen correct or not correct? What kind of mistakes are there? And then when you design, you need to select correct materials. Now, materials are a very difficult topic because it's very wide. We cannot cover it in one lecture. This is just in general material selection factors. So what factors you need to take into consideration for to choose a correct material or group of materials? So when we say, for example, plastic, it's not just one type. We have hundreds of different types. When we say rubber, it's not one type. When we say metal, we have so many different types. And we have a lot of materials nowadays. So these factors will help you at least to know what category of materials to focus on. But in reality, you need a complete class and even more than one class to really understand materials, because there are so many nowadays. So let us start and see what we have. So what are materials? They are the stuff of design. Everything is made out of materials. If you look around you, okay, everything is made out of materials. So materials are so important that even the ages that we have lived in, or man before us have lived in, we are living only in our age, but I mean in the past, okay? It has been defined by material. For example, Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, and so on. Then the Silicon Age that mostly our age is known of, because when the silicon was discovered, which is this one, it made it possible for technology to develop. So that's why it's called the Silicon Age. But really nowadays, we have basically millions of materials, I would say. Never in history has an age had so many material choices. Today you have so many material choices because of the technological development. A lot of materials, sub-materials were discovered. So for example, online, you can find complete databases like with millions of material choices. And for each one, they can write you the characteristics, the properties, the what it could be used for. It can really get very complicated. So when you come to decide what exactly material to use for a new design. So let us see what are some important factors to consider when choosing materials. Now, I said it doesn't have to be a one material because we have so many, but at least what category should I look for? Should I look in the category of metals? Should I look in the category of plastics? These are major categories of materials. So you need to know where to look first, then to find the one material that you need. So the function of the product is very important for to decide what material is suitable to be able to do this function. Now, for example, look at this powered device. It's a drill. Now, you need to understand how a drill functions, what kind of job does it do? What kind of task should the human do with this device so that you can decide what suitable materials to choose? Now, can you do this part here out of rubber, like this, for example, material to put it here? Well, if you do it, it will not be able to drill holes. It will not be able to function correctly. You need to consider this machine is also vibrating. It's vibrating when you use it. So what material should you use for the body, for the handle? If you remember when we covered physical characteristics of products, we talked about a lot of things. We talked about the shape, for example, texture, a lot of things. But the material type, it's also very important. So for example, what if a product conducts heat? What if this, for example, handle where you put your hand can become hot? Then you need to choose a material that is not conducting the heat or electricity, okay? So it's very important how this product functions, what exactly the human does with it, what tasks, and then it can help you to choose the correct category of materials to do the function, and at the same time to fit the human and not to endanger the human. The economic background. Now, you need to consider this item that you're designing, this product or system or whatever you can call it, what will be the end selling price? So because the cost is related to the material. So it's different if I want this product to design, for example, this kind of product, and the end selling price in the shop to be 1 JD, or it's different than if it's 20 JD. The materials that I use, so that influences the price. Some materials are cheap, some materials are very expensive. So, for example, I can choose a very good quality metal, okay? For example, but that will also be high in cost. That will make the end selling price of this product high. If I choose cheap materials, I have to be very careful also. Now I want the end selling price to be cheap, but I have to still choose materials that will, well, do the function correct, not endanger the human. So you need to find some middle ground. I don't want it too high cost. I don't want it too low, because also this affects the quality of the end product. So this is a big thing to consider. What is the end cost? And if you have a device, not a simple hand tool, if you have a device, you need to consider maintenance costs, frequency of replacement of the different parts. For example, a part gets damaged, I throw it away, I buy a new one and replace it. So for devices, for expensive devices, You don't throw away the device after something gets broken. You maintain it. You replace the broken part with a new part, but this costs. This also costs money. So in reality, the designer's job is not easy. So it's not only about drawing on the paper a nice shape and say, okay, this is a new design. No, you have to consider every detail of it. And materials are part of these details that need to be considered. Because whatever you're designing in the end will be manufactured, will be produced, and it will be sold to the people for money in the shops. So this relates, materials relate to this cost, relate to the function, relate to how the human will interact with this product and how the human will feel by touching these materials. Everything you touch, you know, around you. To do a task, I need to touch this, okay? Human machine touching points. So I'm touching what? The materials. So even the way how the materials feel is important. Production quantities and methods, okay? This is also something that influences the choice of materials. So how many of this product will be manufactured? This relates to what? How many people will be using this? What is your target group of people? So if your target group of people are millions of people all over the world, okay, this means we have huge production quantities, many, 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 okay? This influences what materials you will choose. If you have big production quantities or just a few, you want to produce just five of these. It's different than if you produce 50 million. So the material choices influence, or I would say rather, the production quantities influence the material choice. The production quantities and methods. What methods are used to produce this? Now, this is something you don't have knowledge in, the methods of production, but you need to consider in general that each material is produced in a different way. Like when we say plastic, for example, the methods are different than if you produce metal. If you make the shapes, you see this? The metal, it's made out of a shape, it's made into a shape. The plastic, this is made into shapes. So the methods, the production methods are different for each material. Now, some production methods, again, are expensive. Some are more cheap. This is very general, okay? So if you have huge production quantities of a product, then if I use a production method that's expensive, it's okay. Because I'm producing a lot. But if I produce just a few pieces, just a few, and I use a very expensive production method, this will be a problem. This will considerably raise the final cost of this. But if I produce millions of this, even if the production method is expensive, still the final cost can be low of the final product. So production quantities and what methods will be used should also be a factor in consideration of your material choices. Now, at this stage, just know this in general. You don't have knowledge exactly of production methods, but you should know that this influences the quantities and the methods influence the material choices. The marketing. So, to remind you, everything we design for what, for whom, for human use, okay? So when you design this again, you're designing this for humans, for people, for your target group to use. So what are the expectations of your target group of people, your the customer, we would say, the person who will, the people who will buy this, what do they expect? Okay. This can relate to the psychology. This can also relate to, for example, when I'm in the shop and I want to buy a cutter, I touch them. I touch this one. I touch another design. I touch several. Sometimes the feel of the materials draw me to the product. So I kind of like how this feels. And in my hand, it kind of sits well. Oh, okay, I will buy this, okay? If I touch another design, maybe I'm not so comfortable with. Sometimes it's these kind of things that influence who will buy the product and how many people will buy. The marketing, okay? It's, well, when you design something for the people, you want the people to like it and to buy it, right or not? So, if you design something and you sell something that people don't want, don't like, by looking at it or by touching it, then we have a problem, okay? Now, the materials that this is made of vastly influences whether people will buy it or not buy it, like it or not like it. So you need to be careful. The material choice can influence the marketing of the product. And you have to consider these things because everything you design will be sold, will be first manufactured, made, and then sold into a store to the people. So these things cannot be ignored. The safety. Obviously, when you choose materials for any product, you have to consider that these materials have to be safe for the human, okay? This is very important factor in material selection. So if you select a material that's dangerous, so if I use this, it's dangerous for me, obviously that's a bad choice. Now, materials are not alone influencing whether a product is dangerous. For example, the shape we discussed before in the physical characteristics. Like, for example, the shape of the product can be made in a way so that when I use it, it's safe. Every detail of the shape is also important. But here in this section, we are focusing on materials. So the materials can contribute to the safety or make it unsafe. For example, if this part of the product was not a rubber, but let's say a slippery material. So when I put my hand here, it keeps slipping and going towards the knife. This will make it a dangerous choice. But because it's a rubber, my hand cannot slip. So it's a safer choice. This is a simple example. Now, the more complicated the product, if it's a machine and you have several materials, it gets more and more complex. So, but you have to keep in mind always, whatever I choose material, it has to be safe for human use. The appearance, the aesthetics, how the product looks. Is it beautiful? Is it ugly? This is also important. Now, each of these factors, we are discussing it alone, but they are related to other factors. For example, if the product is ugly, not beautiful, then this will influence the marketing. We discussed a little bit about the marketing, meaning that when this is sold in the store, okay, and when I look at it, it's ugly. I don't like the shape. I don't like the way this looks. I don't like the material. Now, I will not buy it. Now, again, it's not only the material, it's also the way the shape looks, okay? It's also the way it feels, it's also the way it functions, okay? But we are talking here only about materials. The material itself, the choice of material, can make a product more beautiful or less beautiful. So the aesthetics. Of course, it can influence other things. We discussed also safety and so on, so on, so on. But the beauty is also important because this can influence how many people will look at it and like it and want to buy it. So, everything, the material, the way it feels, the color, the way light reflects, the finishing, you know, the finishing, the small details, everything of the material can influence the beauty. And aesthetics is also a big part of design. If you design something that functions really well, and the human can do the tasks perfectly and everything's great, but it's not beautiful, it will influence how many people will buy this product or want to buy it. So aesthetics is also a major part of any design. And the materials affect aesthetics in a big way. Corrosion resistance is another factor. Now this depends on if you're focusing on a specific category of materials such as metals, okay? Now we have some metals that corrode easily, some metals that are corrosion resistant. So for example, some steels, again, we don't have one type of steel, we have several types of steels from cheap to expensive. So the cheap ones, with time, they will start maybe get affected. The expensive steels, for example, are totally corrosion resistant. So no matter how much water you put, dampness in the environment, they will not corrode. So for example, if you choose a specific type of metal for the product, you need to decide, do I need it to be corrosion resistant or not? This depends on what? Again, what is the function of this? How will I use it and where will I use it? In what kind of environment? We discussed environment before, the importance of the environment where the product will be used. So will I use this product in a dry environment or will I use it in water and wet and damp environments all the time? So where is this going to stay, this metal? Now, if I have to use it with water, with dampness, with, you know, like these kind of things, then maybe it will have to be to some degree corrosion resistant. It depends, of course, on what's the quality you want it to be, this final product. High quality, low quality, medium quality. This also affects what type of material you will use. But in general, do I need it to be corrosion resistant or not? This is the major question to ask. This is influenced by the environment around us. Where is this going to be used? So we discussed before, the environment is a very important factor to consider because it can influence a lot of things on this design, and materials are part of this decision you need to make. Now, if it's something that's used outdoors and it's not corrosion resistant, and it will start corroding after a while, well, whatever it is, the product is destroyed. So you need to replace it, and this will cost more money. The weight. So the weight, how heavy is this, okay? So you need to consider, do I use this manually? Do I have to carry it? Do I have to, again, how is this used by the human? What tasks are being performed? And if it's, for example, a machine, some machines can be very heavy. So do you have to pick up the machine or not? So the weight is important to consider, and the weight has a relationship with material. So some materials are heavy, some materials are lighter. For example, some metal types can be very heavy, while some plastics can be very light in weight. But then again, you cannot make everything light in weight because some machines need to be heavy. And sometimes because of the function, you cannot make something out of plastic. You cannot make this out of plastic because it will not function right. It cannot cut. So sometimes you are forced to use heavier materials so that the product can do the function. That's totally normal. But in general, you need to consider if you have several choices of materials, and you need to consider how this product will be used, what will be the final weight of it? Should it be heavy? Should it be light? Should it be how it will be handled by the human? This influences the choice of materials in general. Considering also the other factors, you need to meet all the factors. You cannot just consider weight and forget about the other factors. All the factors together need to be considered for the final correct choice. Now, you need to also think about sometimes. Now, you will say, okay, what is better, a heavy or a lighter, for example, product? Again, this depends on the function, okay? But sometimes some products are deliberately made a little bit heavier to influence the psychology of the user. For example, let's consider mobiles, okay? When I'm in the store and I want to buy a mobile, I will touch mobiles, okay? I'm touching the materials and I'm feeling the weight, okay? So, oh, this is kind of heavy a little bit. Then I'm touching another mobile and this is kind of light in weight. Now, how can the weight of the materials influence me to want to buy this? Sometimes in some products, when you feel them, when you touch them, and they're a little bit heavier than expected, this can make the people, the customer feel that maybe the quality of this mobile that is heavier is better than the other mobile that is very light in weight. This is a psychological thing, okay? But in reality, maybe the quality of both of them are the same, but I feel that the heavy one is a little bit higher in quality. So what I mean here is, you can sometimes in some products with the choice of material influence the buyer, the customer, the people who will buy this product by a psychological method, by making them feel that the quality is better when in fact it isn't. So the psychology of the viewer, the buyer of this product is very important, okay? Now, it's not only the weight, it's all the factors that we talk about important to influence whether I will like this product or I will not like it. But the weight also plays a role. Shock forces. So you need to consider how this product, whatever you're designing, will be used and where, okay? If you're designing something that will be used outdoors, now the mobile is used where, in what kind of environments? It's used basically everywhere, indoors, outdoors, everywhere. So, what if I drop this mobile while using outdoors? Outdoors, it's different than indoors in your home. In your home, maybe you have a carpet on the ground. If this falls, it's not a big problem. Maybe I'm sitting on a chair, so the height is not too high. But let's say, for example, you're using your mobile while walking outside. And this falls down on the ground and on a stone and breaks. It can happen because this is used indoors and outdoors. So the shock forces, how much can this take before it breaks? So for example, if you drop it from 1 meter, will it break? If you drop it from top of the building, will it break or not break? Okay, so how much shock forces, how much shock can this take? Now mobiles are made with, you know, not made, but you can put plastic covers. You see this rubber, so that it's protected a little bit. So if it falls down like this on the ground, the rubber, the shock forces are not so strong on the mobile. The rubber absorbs the shock. The rubber material absorbs the shock, so your mobile does not break easily. Now, some devices are designed specifically for very, very rough environments. So they are specifically designed for to be used in very rough outdoor environments where constantly there are shock forces on the device. Now, these kind of devices use materials that are different than materials used in this device. This device is not designed to basically survive in extreme shock forces. So if I start hitting it, dropping it, it's not designed to survive in this. But some mobiles on the market you will find extremely strong, designed using materials that basically absorb shock forces that can survive, material types that can survive even if you drop it 100 times. Even if a car crashes on it, it will not break, okay? But again, you cannot design all the products around you using such tough, strong materials because they are expensive. So we are again back to the cost of the materials. If you want to use very high quality materials, they will be expensive. So you need to find a middle ground. So this product to survive a certain level of shock, but it's not that strong to survive all kinds of shock. So you need to consider what should be the end selling price of this product. And this will influence again the quality of materials and types of materials that you can use. So as you can see, all the factors are related together. So human, how the human will use this product, where the human will use this product, how expensive or cheap this product is, everything relates also, it relates back to the material choice. The materials are a big part of all of this picture. The temperature also affects the choice of materials. So if you are going to use a certain product around high temperatures, again, the environment, maybe you're using it outdoors in the sun, in the very hot sun. So the temperature of the material will rise. So if I put this in the sun, what will happen with the materials, okay? If it's going to be used outdoors. But normally, most cutters I'm using indoors. Some cutters I'm using outdoors, of course, but not all of them. Now, what will happen to a material when you put it under the sun? Maybe if it's basically getting hot, when I touch it, it's not such a good idea, okay? So it has to be a material that doesn't get hot. Like for example, a pan in the kitchen where you cook your food, okay? The handle of it, okay? If it's made out of metal that conducts the heat, when you touch it, you will burn yourself. So that's not a good idea. You have to consider there is a fire, there is heat, and the material should not be able to conduct the heat where your body part will come in contact with the product. Now, temperature also relates to not only very high temperatures, but to very low temperatures. If when it gets really cold, also this can influence the materials. Like some materials can expand and some can shrink depending on the temperature. This also, depending on what kind of device you're designing, this also influences the material choice. Because this can sometimes even endanger the safety. If a material shrinks or expands, this can, in a device, this can also make it dangerous. So really a lot of details need to be considered. And what I'm covering is just so basic. It's so general, you know? But in reality, when you really design something, you need to go into much more details. The vibration is another factor to be considered when you choose materials. So if you, for example, design a device that vibrating, so you know, it makes this kind of vibration, the materials that you choose should be in a way, or part of the materials that are in this device should be shock absorbent, because you don't want this vibration to get directly to the human. Now, some machines, they have strong vibrational forces. So imagine if you are a worker and you work with this machine all day long, every day, and this vibration hits your body, it will damage you. It will make your extremities numb after a time, a certain period of time, you will stop feeling your hands. Yes. The vibration can make you stop feeling your body because it destroys the nerves, the nerve endings in your body. It destroys them. So machines that have strong vibrations need to have materials in them that absorb the vibration, at least absorb part of the vibration, so that it doesn't hit the human body directly. So, this is in powered machines. You don't have vibration here. You don't have vibration here. These are basic products, basic systems, hand tools. These don't have vibration. But the powered machines, some powered machines have vibration. Now you need to consider, is the vibration really strong or is it very light? If it's very light, it's not a big problem. But if it's a strong vibration, you need to consider what materials can I use to dampen this vibration. Vandalism. Vandalism is another factor that influences material choice. Again, this depends where, in what environment will this product be used. Now, for example, the car. The car is usually parked outside. It's not in your home, it's outside. So a lot of people will pass by, children will play around your car, maybe hit your car with a stone, maybe a lot of things can happen. Deliberately damage your car, okay? This is vandalism, when someone deliberately breaks something or damages. And this usually happens where? In public places. Outside, on the street, okay? Not in your home. So, the materials that you choose for, let's say, products that are going to be used in public places should be strong enough to resist vandalism. So if someone comes and breaks it, or by accident or deliberately, the material should be in a way strong enough to resist this damage. For example, elevators that go up and down, you know, the controls, they are used by, again, thousands of people in public places. Again, the material choices should be so that after thousands and thousands of people use it, touch it, push it, so it doesn't get broken. So consider vandalism, and this is also related, as I said, to the environment where the product will be used. If it's a public place, vandalism is increased in possibility. So the material choices should be so that this can resist possible breakage. Fire. You have to consider that sometimes fire hazards happen, okay? And some materials, how shall I say, are fire resistant, while other materials can very quickly contribute to a fire. Like, for example, your the materials that your sofa is made at home. Okay, the sofa where you sit on and relax in your home. The material it is made of. Some materials are very low quality, and a small spark, you know, can immediately in seconds put the whole sofa into fire, and it can spread through your home very fast. Other materials of higher quality and higher price also could be, in this respect, more fire resistant. So here we have again material choices. Some are fire resistant, some are not fire resistant, and it depends on their quality and their price. It's always related, you know, the quality and the price. And the function, is it fire resistant? This is a function or not? So you need to decide in your product that you're designing, do you need the materials to be fire resistant or not? Sometimes it is important, sometimes it is less important. Depends on what is it that you're designing. What is it, okay? And where will it be placed? How it will be used? Then you decide how important it is for a material to resist fire or not resist fire. If it's a material that's placed, a product that is used around high temperatures and fire normally, then you need to be very careful, okay, with the choice of materials, because the fire can easily spread. Solvents. So solvents, another important factor that influences material choice. If you have a product, for example, okay, what will happen if, for example, I clean it with a certain solvent, a chemical material, okay? Will these materials get damaged? Now, also you need to think about, again, how will I use this? Do I clean this a lot or not? Now, if it's, for example, I don't clean this a lot in reality, this product, but if it's a kitchen tool, what is this? A spoon, okay? This one all the time gets cleaned, all the time. All the time gets underwater, I scrub it, I clean it, I put solvents on it, okay? So you need to consider, again, how is the product going to be used? Where is it going to be used? And what kind of solvents, materials, the chemical materials will come in contact with it? And if they do, will they damage the product? So if I splash some Hypex on this or flash, will it get destroyed? This is made out of what? A material, okay? So this material, will it get destroyed by these solvents or not? Another product that you don't normally wash or use solvents on, again, the material of that product, again, should influence the use. So the question is, will the product come in contact with solvents and what kind of solvents? And sometimes accidents can happen. So you need to take that into consideration. So what materials to choose, so that they don't get damaged by the solvents that they come in contact with. Animals, insects, you know, bugs, these kind of stuff. So some materials like wood, for example, wood is a natural material. Now, some materials we have, again, categories. Some are natural, some are not natural. They're, you know, they cannot get damaged by bugs or insects or in this respect. But if you're using natural materials in a product, let's say wood, you need to be very careful because it's easily attacked by bugs because it's a natural product. Now, sometimes they put, you know, they cover natural materials with a protective surface, you know, so that the insects don't come and lay eggs or, you know, like attack the material, but still, this is a consideration. So for example, if you design a kitchen tool, that has, for example, you know, some handles of some of the tools are made out of wood. Okay, but this kitchen tool, I'm using it all the time. In what kind of environment? In the kitchen environment, in water, in the sink. Maybe I will put it inside the sink with the dirt and, you know, all of these things. Even if it's dry, it's still the wooden material has, it's porous. Porous, it means it has small holes in it. And this can absorb moisture, it can absorb water, it can make bugs, insects easily attack it. Okay? So, your product, in what kind of environment will it be used? Will it have moisture, damp, you know, surrounding? Will it be used inside water? Will it be used with in contact with the ground? Where it will be used? This can influence whether it is a good idea to use natural materials or better to use not natural materials, okay? That's because you need to consider the fact that bugs attack natural materials often, okay? Especially in warm climates, okay? So it depends on the climate, it depends on the environment. Where is it going to be used, this product and this material that this product is made of? Dirt. Well, we talked about dirt in general when we talked about other factors, but it has to be considered because every product we use will become eventually dirty, okay? In contact with our body, in contact with the environment, it will become dirty. So when you clean it, when you want to clean, well, what will happen to the materials? Will they get damaged by the cleaning or not? We discussed this when we discussed the solvents. So this should be considered. Some products are never cleaned, but some products you clean them daily. So what is the product? How does it function? Where is it going to be used? In what environment? And how? Weathering is like, for example, when you have a like this kind of signs and it's put outdoors, again, the environment, okay, influences the materials. So for example, this material, what is this material made of? Even this ink, you know, like this can be, this is also a material. The ink you use to print on something, this is also a material. So what about the weathering? What if a lot of sun, ultraviolet light comes on this? Maybe with time, it will become pale. The writing become pale. The material will get damaged. What if cold and rain comes on this? What will happen to the material? Again, it depends on the weathering, how the product will get influenced by the weathering. This is related to the environment. Where are you going to use this product? Outdoors, indoors, always outdoors. This influences. The environment inside the home is different than outside regarding weathering, okay? So you need to understand and consider, will my product, where my product will be used and how weathering can influence it. So what materials can I use to prevent this from happening? But again, if you use high quality materials, very high quality, it will add to the cost. It will become more expensive, okay? If you use lower quality, it will reduce the cost, but maybe it will be a bad quality materials that will get damaged quicker. So what is it that you're aiming at with the choice of materials for this product? Okay, this is a very important decision to make. Noise. Materials should be chosen again to reduce noise and not increase noise. So in products that are very noisy, like in some machines, that are very noisy. Again, some materials that are chosen are chosen so that they can reduce the noise from this machine. Okay, it absorbs, it reduces the noise that you can hear, because everybody knows that extreme high noises, sounds are not healthy for the human. You can damage your ears. So it's not healthy, it's not safe. Safety is very important in ergonomics. So high noise is not a good idea. So the materials need to be in a way to reduce this noise as much as possible that comes from the devices, the machines, whatever, okay? Even in headphones, okay, look, this material here is put for several reasons, for example, this soft, you know, material, so that, okay, it's put so that when I put it on my ears, it's comfortable, like when it touches my ear, it's not a plastic, you know, it doesn't, it's comfortable, but also for the noise. So this material also dampens a little bit the extreme noise. So this influences the noise and the comfort of the user. So what material you will use in machines, in devices that have noise? Okay. So these were the factors, some of the basic, very basic factors that you need to consider when analyzing tools, devices, whatever, basic systems, mechanical systems, whatever, for mistakes in the choice of materials. And when you design a new device and you want to choose the correct materials, these factors need to be considered. Again, the materials are part of the overall physical characteristics of a product. There are many physical characteristics. Go back to the other lectures and see what we discussed, okay, about physical characteristics of a tool. Materials are also part of this physical characteristics, and the factors that we discussed are important when finding mistakes in the choice of materials, or when designing and solving problems and trying to choose the correct materials in a tool or device. Okay, thank you for listening, and see you in the next lecture soon.